Hello everyone, my name is Ricardo Villalobos.
And I'm David McAgan.
We are part of the Windows Azure incubation team with EPE.
We work with partners worldwide to help them architect solutions for Windows Azure.
Recently, we did a series of events worldwide where we talk about the openness of the Windows Azure platform. And we decided to capture those learnings.
Right, so this is a six-part series where we're taking some of the highlights from the Open Platform Summit. And we'll take a look at computing, we'll look at the developer story, and we'll take a look at the data story.
So for part one, we're going to talk about platform service, infrastructure service, and virtual networks, or how to combine them. So let's get rolling, David.
Excellent. So we already know that we have this world-class infrastructure. We have eight data centers worldwide. Actually, we have many more than eight data centers, but we have eight running Windows Azure. I think we're running some other things as well in the data centers.
Yeah, we have Xbox Live, we have Outlook.com, we have Bing. Yep. Amazing infrastructure worldwide. Managed by Global Foundation Services. And
right.
That is the foundation of our platform.
Yep.
Now, on top of that, what do we have there? We have three pillars, right?
Right. So we divide those pillars into three fundamental areas. We have compute, we have data management, and we have networking.
Correct. And then what makes the app, the platform so open is that we have a REST interface on top of those pillars. And actually, we are using that REST interface to build other services like mobile services, media services, etc.
Yep, and it's as a developer, of course, you can use those REST services, or you could build PowerShell or command line scripts. But to make it a little bit easier, we also built SDKs on top of the REST.
Correct,
services.
And that's what we're showing now. We have obviously a .NET SDK, but we also have a Java SDK, a PHP SDK, a Node SDK, Python, and most recently Ruby.
Right.
So this is why we consider the platform of it, because you can communicate with the different components or the pillars multiple ways from multiple programming languages.
Yep.
All right, so let's start with compute, which is what part one is about. And we have three ways to use Windows Azure Compute, David. Let's start with the first one.
Yep, so the first one we call Platform as a Service, PaaS. And effectively, that's just a fancy way of saying we have a stateless server.
Correct.
Right.
The second one is virtual machines, which we actually GA a few weeks ago back in April. And that's the concept of taking virtual machines created with a virtualization framework, in this case Hyper-V, and being able to upload them to the cloud and stateful instances where you can install multiple frameworks and multiple platforms.
Right. And the third one is websites. Sometimes we joke around, call it PaaS Plus, because it is platform as a service. But this is a facility where you can host your web application. You still get all the scale of Windows Azure and reliability and availability, but it's even less to worry about. You strictly worry about your code, and that's it.
Level a different level of abstraction from the regular PaaS, correct. And we're going to talk deeper
about this. We'll go deeper
in
each one of these,
definitely. Sure. All right, so let's start with the basic concept for platform as a service, which is what we've been promoting for the last 3 years, right? But it's important to understand what it offers today.
So we have a stateless server. Imagine somebody else takes care of your operating system.
Correct.
And when the operating system boots up, it then takes the code that you've developed, attaches it, and runs it. Which is a really nice model, especially when you think about OS maintenance.
Yep. What's interesting about this and having stateless machines is that you don't store anything in the local storage, which means that, first of all, you get a free load balancer that you can use to scale and then open endpoints that are basically going to allow the application to communicate with the world. And then what is the second consequence of having stateless machines? Where do you put your storage, David?
Well, that's an issue. If you have two or three instances, you can't store them on the local disk. So
Correct.
We do have to externalize storage. Now, we'll go into storage more deeply in another session, but this could be a SQL server or table storage or any other mechanism that's not stored directly on the individual virtual machines.
But I will say that the key word is stateless. As long as you remember that, I think that it makes the process of design architecture much simpler.
Right. So one thing that you mentioned is endpoints. So what's an endpoint?
An endpoint is basically a port that you can open on the load balancer to communicate with those instances. Now, for PaaS, it's always a balanced endpoint, which means that it's going to be communicating with each instance in a round-robin fashion.
And that means you could have websites running, maybe a data service running. You can have any type of endpoint-driven application running.
Correct. So those are the basic concepts. Now, there are some benefits to PaaS. The first one is that it's faster. You can go from the having the idea to deploy really quickly from the IDE. The second one, David?
Well, it's certainly cheaper, right? Because you're not managing, it's cheaper from IT resource
Correct.
Perspective, because nobody's managing the OS images
Exactly.
and update patches and things like that. You can just focus on your application development, which
Correct.
Is all either done in the IDE or wherever you normally, you know, write your code and
yeah.
you bundle up in a deployment package, and that's really it.
See, these processes are automated. Mm-hmm. Also, the third benefit is that there's a lower risk of having human errors or human mistakes. So those mm-hmm. are the three benefits that we find with PaaS, right?
Yep.
And we're going to talk about the decision tree that you can follow to choose one yep. over the other.
And you mentioned automation, which means we have PowerShell support and we have other command line support. So
excellent. So now let's talk about the basic concepts for infrastructure as a service, which are not that different from PaaS. But you start from the idea of having a virtual machine or a physical server that you want to move to the cloud. With a virtualization framework like Hyper-V, you can take those VHD files and upload them to the cloud. Now, are they going to end up like standalone machines in the cloud? What happens to those VHD files, David?
Right, so, well, you know, you could also build your image in the cloud in case
that's
you don't
right.
have something
to upload. That's correct, but this right. is a common pattern that we have found, right?
Right, and so once you have this VHD in the cloud, it's stored in a persistent way.
Correct.
And then you could use that as a cookie cutter, as
yes.
a baseline for additional virtual machines.
Correct.
I think one of the key differences when you get into IaaS, though, is that each of those VHDs
yes.
Starts a life of its own once you make a copy.
Right.
Where PaaS is stateless and everything always starts from that same starting point.
Yep.
IaaS, as you make copies, that's where the VHD takes on a life of its own. So if you have three instances, you can have three independent virtual machines running.
What's important to remember is when you upload your VHD or you create it in the cloud, as you mentioned, it's going to end up inside this container that we call a cloud service, mm-hmm. which basically is a cloud computing unit. It's a boundary where you have your management, your configuration, your security, your networking, et cetera.
Load balancing, scaling, right.
By default, you're going to get an implicit free load balancer in front of your virtual machine. And that's really important to understand because that's how you're going to start building complex architectures based on these cloud services.
Right.
Now, when you deploy multiple machines, each one is going to end up in its own cloud service. What happens if you want to start doing load balancer or if you want to start scaling, which is something that is really simple to do with PaaS? So the question is, how to scale infrastructure service? And the answer is, David?
We're going to deploy multiple virtual machines within that same cloud service.
Exactly. And the benefits of doing that, as the slide is showing, are multiple. First of all, mm-hmm. you can balance endpoints. You can forward endpoints, which is something you can do with PaaS. But in this case, you can also just forward the endpoints, not only balance in a round-robin fashion.
Yeah, that's an important aspect. So if you have a web server, you're typically going to load balance that endpoint.
Yes.
But let's say that there is one specific, I don't know, a database server. And
yes.
let's say you made that available to the outside world.
Correct.
And you're running it only on one machine.
Yes.
In that case, you would have a forwarded endpoint.
Correct. And also, you can define availability sets for those instances inside the same cloud service, right? Which basically is what you do with PaaS. You have update domains, fault domains,
right.
which simplifies the process, automating those processes, making sure that the end user experience is something that's acceptable.
Yep. I think there's two key advantages to the availability set.
Yes.
One is if Microsoft decides to update the underlying OS, we'll make sure we do that to separate machines in the availability set.
Right.
And the other is limiting risk, you
Correct.
Mentioned, from the end user perspective.
Yes.
So we make sure we separate the virtual machines in terms of physical hardware.
Correct. And when the virtual machines are inside the same cloud service, there's an implicit DNS in addition to the implicit load balancer, so which means that they can see each other by name, not only by the
right.
internal IP address. And that's a benefit.
And you mentioned it as a container.
Yes.
That also goes for the networking. So if one machine can talk to another within the cloud service, it cannot be talking to a machine in another cloud service.
Right, and automatically when you have virtual machines inside the same cloud service, the SLA is higher.
Right.
Okay, so let's demo how easy it is to create a virtual machine in Windows Azure. I access my portal, and then I click on virtual machines, and now I'm gonna select the text where it says create a virtual machine. In this case, I'm gonna create one from the gallery. I'm gonna select the SQL Server 2012 SP1 web, because that's the version that I need. I provide the name for the machine, it's going to be internal, and let's say that I want to install SQL in it myself, I'm going to select the size of the machine. This is how you scale up. Also enter my name and a password. And obviously it's going to check that the strength of the password is the appropriate one. Also, I need to enter the name of the computer as it's going to be recognized from the outside world. And I'm going to use this, the exact same one. Then the storage account where the machine is going to be used. And finally, the region where I want to store this computer, which I'm selecting West US. This is where you can also create or select an availability set, as we talked about this earlier. And at the same time, I can enable PowerShell remoting for administration purposes. And all I have to do now is click on complete, and my machine will be ready in about 4 to 5 minutes. This is how easy to create a new virtual machine in Windows Azure. All right, David, so now we have PaaS and IaaS, and I can deploy multiple cloud services to my Windows Azure subscription. Some of them might be PaaS, and actually that shows I can scale like that. And some of them might be virtual machines, but at the end of the day, they are cloud services in my subscription.
Yes.
Is there's something missing here, because you might want those instances to see each other.
Right, so one clarification is that within a given cloud service, it's either all PaaS.
Yes.
Or all IaaS.
Correct.
So this poses what seems to be a challenge.
Yes.
If, let's say, we have our web server that wants to talk to a database server.
Correct.
And we built our web server in PaaS. So one thing that we can use to combine the two, we would use something called Azure Virtual Networking.
Excellent. So what happens is you have those multiple cloud services in your subscription, and you can basically create a boundary between cloud services, inside those cloud services, that we call a virtual network.
Yep.
And now the machines can see each other. And this is very powerful, because let's say that you're building an application with a web front end, and you want to deploy some type of database engine that is not offered as a service, or that it has some restrictions that you cannot live with. Now you can deploy those frameworks in virtual machines and communicate those with your PaaS deployment.
And what's nice about using the virtual network is you don't have to worry about endpoint security.
Correct.
If you kept your IaaS database cloud service with an external endpoint, you'd have to worry about access control and encrypting the line, you know, with SSL
Correct.
Or other techniques.
Exactly, because you're going to always use external endpoints, but it's not really safe, secure, right? So what are the benefits of virtual network? Just to summarize, you can interconnect cloud services, first of all. Even if it's multiple virtual machine cloud services, they can see each other, or PaaS and IaaS.
Right.
The other thing that we're going to talk about in the next part of this presentation is how to connect with on-premises resources.
Right, and that's actually really cool, extending the reach of the cloud into a different facility.
And we like to emphasize the power of combining PaaS plus IaaS. It's something that we believe creates great architectures and covers a lot of the use cases that we're finding in the field.
Yep.
So to summarize, David, Windows Azure is ready for real-world cloud architectures.
Right, and we have a few options. We have PaaS, if you want very straightforward scalability and maintainability.
Mm-hmm.
We have IaaS, which allows you to bring your legacy apps or very complex apps that might not fit in the PaaS model.
Right.
And then we have virtual networks, which helps us connect the two.
Yes, and again, in part two, we're going to talk about how to connect this to on-premises resources. So David, I think that this wraps part one of the presentations. Thank you for joining me today.
And thank you.
And thank you everyone for watching.